Kia ora, Nikki. Would you like to start proceedings?
Kia ora, everybody. Good evening. Whakataka te hau ki te uru, whakataka te hau ki te tonga. Kia ma kinakina ki uta, kia ma taratara ki tai. Ehi aki ana te atakura, hei tio, hei huka, hei hohu, tihei moriora.
Kia ora. Now, my haere mai, welcome to the second in our Centennial Speaker Series. Our first took us into the heart of our forests. Today, we find out how you can encapsulate 100 years of history in four tiny postage stamps. With us today, Nikki Snow-Yink, who is Forest and Birds Regional Conservation Manager, Canterbury West Coast. Scott Burnett is Forest and Birds Regional Conservation Manager in Te Tohu, top of the south, also from that beautiful part of the Motu. Connor Wallace, a member of the ecological field team. Te Hoere Bat Recovery Project and National Coordinator of Forest and Bird Youth. Also with us, Sam Lincoln, another of our five speakers tonight. Sam is the Ark in the Park Program Manager in Tamaki Makaurau, Auckland. And Lynette Townsend from New Zealand Post. She's the Stamp Design Team Lead. And we got to know her really well. Worked very closely with Lynette on our Centennial Stamp Collection. Hope you've had a chance to see it. Before we hear from each of them, just a brief explanation on how things are going to work this evening. Each of our Forest and Bird speakers will chat about an element of each of the stamps, and Lynette will explain how artist Rachel Walker approached this intriguing and in many ways challenging commission in the process of turning her detailed prints into stamps. Now, we will have time for your questions towards the end of the hour. So if you could pop them into the Q&A section and attach a name if it's for a particular panel member. Capturing conservation history on a stamp, of course, is our theme. As background, the four artworks represent Forest and Birds Whakapapa by depicting landscapes and species of significance to the society and its membership. They time travel. We start in Kapiti Island, reflecting Forest and Birds' origins, to the Buller Plateau, which represent the current conservation concerns and future work. And they depict the four main areas of Forest and Birds' conservation work: terrestrial, freshwater and marine, climate, and all aspects of the animal kingdom. Well, now, I've got to say, before we start, I've got a particular attachment to postage stamps as the daughter of both a postmaster and a postmistress who met as pen friends. And I grew up literally living in a post office, and I stamped stamps, and it's a very kind of fond and deep memory for me. And I'm also a great admirer of Rachel Walker's distinctive artwork. So it's a special night for me. I'm looking forward to, I'm going to be learning a lot too. I've only been on the job for 3 months. So the presentations will be engaging for me as well. I have some questions, but please send yours in. And we'll get started. Nikki Snow-Yink, we were talking about the first stamp in the collection, Kapiti Island. You, of course, in Canterbury, a long way from Kapiti, but I know you know the island, and I think, in fact, you've been in the Kapiti area recently.
Kia ora, Lynn, and kia ora, everybody. It's a real pleasure to be here this evening, so thanks for inviting me along. Yes, indeed, I am a mainlander based down in Canterbury, and recently I was on the Kapiti coast with my fellow staff member, Amelia, and she took me to visit Val Sanderson's home up there on the Kapiti coast. And from his home, he looks out over Kapiti Island. And it was a really sort of a moving day to be there outside the founder of Forest and Birds' home, where he saw inspiration to create the organisation that we work for now. So this beautiful stamp that Rachel has produced has its inspiration of Kapiti Island, and there it is. Thank you very much for putting it up. And it has four wonderful species that I think are core to the work that we do. In the top left-hand corner, we've got the red-crowned kakariki, and of course the kakapo in the middle, and then to the right of the kakapo is the wonderful tiki or saddleback, and then a couple of tui flittering away off to the right hand side. So yeah, Kapiti Island, the inspiration for the stamp is a predator-free island, and this is what inspired Val Sanderson to kick off Forest and Bird 100 years ago. Yes, forest and bird. Now, I mean, my topic tonight is to talk about pest control, and pest control is something that is vital to New Zealand's nature, and it's kind of at the core of a lot of the work that we do at Forest and Bird to ensure that these creatures that you can see on the stamp have a safe home to live in. Maria Island or Ruapuki up in the Hauraki Gulf was successfully eradicated by rats in a program led by Don Merton back in the 1960s, and supported by members of Forest and Bird up in the area. And so since then, that sort of sparked off this incredible legacy of island eradications to ensure that our native species have a safe home to live in. Much so the fact that New Zealand has become the world leader in island pest eradication. So subsequently to understand the efforts required to make these islands safe for our native species, we've come to understand the uniqueness and the fragility of New Zealand's native plants and animals, birds, lizards, insects and bats. And I guess to cut a long story short, I'm going to talk a little bit about the work that we do in Forest and Bird and a program that has made huge steps since its inception in 2016 called Predator Free 2050. So understanding the uniqueness and specialness of New Zealand's native species required a bunch of really clever people to put their heads together and lobby or create a program called Predator Free 2050 and to get government support for it. So this occurred, developed from a concept in 2016. And this program, Predator Free 2050, focuses on eradicating rats, possums, and stoats. So the main predators that attack these animals, or mustelids, which is your rats and your stoats and your ferrets and your weasels. Initially, the program was funded by $28 million for the government, from the government, and then $7 million for each year subsequently. And since its inception in 2017, it's grown massively. So today we have dozens of community or backyard trapping projects right throughout New Zealand to protect the native species that they have in their backyard. And this is sort of core to the work that all of our forest and bird volunteers do around the countryside. So from the top very tip up there at the top of the North Island to the very south down in Stewart Island, Rakiura, and even below, we've got people working doing predator control programs. Predator Free 2050 is underpinned by three phases. And the first phase is to mobilise. And I guess that's where we are now. And that's we've mobilised thousands of volunteers all around the countryside to get out and do trapping in their backyard. And then the next phase is to accelerate. So that's about where we are at the moment, where it's really growing exponentially with more and more people jumping on the bandwagon to start up a project in their own backyard. So to get a bit of a good coverage right across New Zealand. And then I guess the missing part of the puzzle is the innovation side of things. We've got trapping, but we know that trapping alone is not going to deal with the issue that we have. We've got thousands of species at risk, threatened and at risk of extinction. So we really need to come up with some new tools in the box. So I guess Forest and Bird's work on pest control is multi-pronged. We know we've got a massive task ahead of us, so we've got all these fantastic volunteers doing this work out on the ground. As advocacy staff, our folk are working to support Predator Free 2050, but we also recognise its limitations. So Predator Free, as I mentioned before, includes rats, mustelids, stoats, weasels and ferrets, and possums, but it doesn't include cats, mice, or hedgehogs. So one of our campaigns this year is to encourage the government to expand the scope of Predator-Free 2050 to include these other creatures that are causing havoc on our native species out there. In parallel to that, we're advocating for a Cat Management Act so that domestic cats or companion cats or owned cats can be managed in a way that they are protected and looked after. So these are valued members of people's families, these pet cats that people have. So we need some way of differentiating between owned cats and unowned cats. So we're working in that way. And we're also trying to advocate to get feral cats, hedgehogs, and mice included in the Predator-Free 2050. The other big thing that we are working on is browser control. That's your goats and your deer and that sort of thing, because it's one thing to protect the animals from predators, but we also need to make sure that we've got some habitat left for them. These animals, these wild animals, eat lots of habitat, so we are focusing a campaign on getting better pest control in that respect as well. We're also focusing on this particularly because of the urgency. We've come to understand the special role that healthy native ecosystems play in a climate crisis and the role that they play in helping to provide resilience for us as a species as well, that is part of this ecosystem. So yeah, amazing stamp. The creatures on there inspire this amazing pest control work that we're doing. So I'm going to leave it right there.
Connor, thank you very much, Nikki. Connor, I'll bring you into the conversation here. And we're talking about a species that you particularly love. But the stamp itself that we're talking about features a part of the country I think you've yet to visit, but I'm sure you will.
Yeah, cool. Thank you very much. Hey, everyone. So my name is Connor. I'm going to talk first about one of the gorgeous stamps that we're bringing out, and then I will pivot to talk about my work for Forest and Birds Te Huere Bat Recovery Project. So the stamp that I get to talk about today is inspired by the Tautuku Ecological Sanctuary. So that's a landscape scale restoration project that's being led by three different forest and bird branches in the Catlins. So that's involving the Dunedin branch, the South Otago branch, and the Southern branch. And in the center of the ecological sanctuary is Lens Reserve, which was purchased by funds bequeathed by Iris Lens in 1964. So Forest and Bird volunteers, contractors, and employees are working to restore 600 hectares of land in the sanctuary through a mixture of removing pest plants as well as invasive mammals and other predators. The project involves more than 60 kilometers of trap lines, which I think is amazingly cool. Anyway, so the stamp here is inspired by some of the unique and perhaps maybe lesser known species that inhabit the Catlins. And it's also directly inspired by the freshwater habitats of the Catlins. So in this stamp, we have, of course, the giant southern rata. We have the endemic creeping foxglove. We have the Tautuku forest gecko. We have the golem galaxid. And of course, right in the top corner there, we have the pekapeka tauroa or long-tailed bat. Which brings me to my awesome job. Can I have the PowerPoint up, please? Cool. Thank you very much. So I am part of the ecological field team for FNB's Te Huere Bat Recovery Project. And I have an awesome job because I get to come in here and help build on what has been a volunteer project previously for 12 years. So it's a project in the top of the South Island here in Nelson. We work in four different reserves. So we've got Pelorus Reserve, Brown River Reserve, Kaluk Reserve and Ronga Reserve. And I'm going to talk a little bit about the work that we do and, of course, the bats that we are trying to protect here. Can I have the next slide, please? Awesome. Oh, and can we click through the little animations? Thank you very much. Cool. So there are four main parts to general restoration projects. So it's, you need to collect data. And that means, well, there's two different types of data. There is data at the start of the project, your baseline data. So you can see what sort of pest animals you're dealing with and also what natives you've got to protect. Then, of course, you need to control the pest animals and plants. You need to reintroduce native animals and plants. And then you get more data because you need to be able to assess your progress, make sure that your project's working and that you're on the right track. So next slide, please. Oh, yes, we also promote stuff through social media. Selfless plug there. Okay, cool. So on this slide, we can see some of the bat monitoring work we do. So this is, I think, easily the coolest part of the project. So in these four reserves, we have the long-tailed bat, which is critically endangered, which is why we're doing all of this weed control and pest control. We're getting rid of the pests that eat the bats, and we're getting rid of the weeds that outcompete our native trees that the bats live in. So that's really important work. So over summer in November, December, and January, that's when the long-tailed bats are most active. So we have a team that goes out and tracks the bats and catches them. So the way that we do that is first we need to observe a bat, and then we will find where it lives, which will be roosting in a tree. And our long-tailed bats love really mature matai trees. And then once we've found a tree, we hoist up a trap, and the bats fly into the trap when they come out at night, and we lower the trap down. And then we can do health checks on the bats. So we can weigh them. We can check if they have pups or not. We can band them, which helps us know if they're being recaptured. And we also put radio transmitters on them. So we put little radio transmitter backpacks, and we can see a picture of that in the lower left-hand corner of the slide. It looks like a little tail sticking out of the backpack. And that helps us then track the bats because we can see the top left there, one of those radio antennas. So our bats are really tricky, and they move roost trees every night. So even finding a tree one night isn't good enough because you can't come back the next day and trap the same tree. The bats will have moved. So that's why we stick radio transmitters on them. And again, that's just helping us to assess population growth, find where the bats are, and therefore where we need to be trapping for pest animals. Next slide, please. Cool. Oh, yes, I have some very exciting news. So I was lucky enough to be involved with this bat monitoring work in January of this year. And as I mentioned, we have four project reserves. We've got Pelorus, we've got Kaluk, Brown River, and Ronga. And we have found previously confirmed bat roosts in all of those reserves other than Ronga until this year in January, when we confirmed, we knew that there was bat activity in that reserve, but we didn't have proof of bat roosts, i.e. actually finding a roost that has bats in it. And we did this year, so that's awesome. Particularly because Ronga is a reserve where the community has done massive planting events for about 7 years now. So it really shows that the community has been putting plants in the right place, which is awesome. Next slide, please. Thank you. This is another aspect to that data gathering and monitoring. So some of you might be familiar with these already, but these are examples of tracking cards. So it's a white piece of cardboard with a blob of ink in the middle. And then on top of the ink, you put a blob of peanut butter, and everything in the bush loves peanut butter. And you leave these out, and then the animals come through and they leave their footprints behind. And that lets you know both what species you've got to deal with and also where species are. For example, if we had 10 ink tunnels out in the bush and only two of them had lots of mouse footprints, those would probably be the good places to trap because we know that the animals are there. And just in the examples here, we've got a possum footprint on the top card, and we've got a mixture of rat and mice prints on the bottom one. Can I have my next slide, please? Awesome. This is just some photos of, trapping and our awesome trapping community that we have. So most of our trap lines at Pelorus, and we have 14 trap lines. Most of them are resupplied weekly, and nearly all of that work is done by community volunteers. Next slide, please. Yep, and then this here is an example of weed control. So we need to a lot of people don't really think about it, but we need to get rid of pest trees because pest trees are really, really good at growing and they're really, really good at spreading. And so they outcompete our natives that our bats and other native species rely on. Next slide, please. And yep, this is just a photos from one of those tree planting events at Ronga that I mentioned. You can see we've got a lovely community group and we've got a range of ages and it's awesome. It really is a community project. Next slide, please. Yep, this is part of our data analysis. So we use TrapNZ and other tools which allow us to plot, for example, a heat map based on catches in Pelorus, which allows us to see where we might want to intensify our trap lines or possibly areas in the bush where maybe our traps might need repair because they're not catching anything, that sort of thing. It's really useful data and it helps us measure progress. And last slide, please. Thank you very much. Just a reminder to follow us on Facebook. So you can look us up. We are Forest and Birds Tihuere Bat Recovery Project. Thank you, everyone, for your time.
Thank you, Connor. Your first question for you has already come in fact, from one of our listeners. How does the bat trap work? It looks quite small.
Yeah, that's actually an excellent question. Our bats, the long-tailed ones in particular, are tiny. They're the size of your thumb and they weigh all of 10 grams. So they are absolutely tiny little animals. And the trap we use is called a harp trap. So it's got two sets of strings and one is they're slightly offset of each other. So if the bat is able to weave between one set of strings, it's going to hit the second set of strings. And the strings have enough elasticity to them that they're not going to hurt the bats. And then once the bat hits the string, it slides down the strings into a bag. And what we do with the harp trap is we hoist it up in the tree, which involves ropes and pulleys and all that sort of stuff. But we try to get it as close to the opening in the tree where the bats are roosting as possible so that we catch them all when they come out to forage at night. Great question.
The little heart emojis coming for you. And I know how excited you were to see your first pecker. So we'll come back with more questions, I think. But I'd like to bring Lynette Townsend from New Zealand Post in into the conversation and to find out about the story behind this collection, Lynette.
Oh, kia ora koutou. Ngā mihi. Thank you for inviting me to be a part of this. It's really, really, really wonderful. I'm just going to try and share my screen to bring up a PowerPoint. Here we go. Can everybody see that okay?
That looks great.
Oh, great. Okay. Well, I thought that I would start off by just taking a little step back in history and before getting to the wonderful forest and bird stamps and just sort of show maybe where we've come from. So these two stamps that I'm showing here are a couple of the first New Zealand stamps. So the very first stamp that New Zealand had was produced on or came out on the 18th of July 1855 and it was called a full face queen. And of course queens and kings were a very strong feature of New Zealand stamps for quite a number of years. In fact they still are. We're just about to bring out some new stamps of our new king. But yes, so the 1855 stamp, and that stayed in play just like that for quite a number of years. Some different colourways came in. In 1862, there were 10 different colours of that very just that same stamp. And then it wasn't until 1873 that New Zealand produced, designed and printed our own stamps, and that's the stamp on the right there, which was a newspaper stamp. So that was sort of the stamps featuring kings and queens were around for a very long time. And then in 1898, New Zealand produced a wonderful set of stamps called pictorials, and there were 14 different ones. And we think that we were, if not the first, one of the first countries in the world to actually showcase New Zealand scenery and animals and flora and fauna on our stamps. And some of these stamps are now very iconic. A lot of people collect them. There's images of Hooea, and so they're a really good snapshot of what New Zealand scenery and flora and fauna look like. And then, of course, since 1898, we've produced hundreds and hundreds of stamps, and it's always really important to us now, or has been and still is today, that the stamps and other types of collectibles that we produce very much reflect and celebrate who New Zealand is, that they tell our stories, the people of New Zealand, our cultures, our heritage, our history, and of course the stories that are important to our natural environment and our efforts towards against climate change and to preserve our environment. I just chose to put up four coins because even though we're talking about stamps tonight, we also at New Zealand Post make a lot of coins, and our coins also have a really big environmental focus. So what I'm showing there on the left is our native New Zealand bee. And we produced that as a coin that came out, well, it's actually only just been released, but it was also part of our set of coins showing like a standard set of coins for New Zealand. We always do a Kiwi coin, and each year we focus on a different type of Kiwi. And over the last 3 or 4 years, the key focus has been on conservation efforts. I'm showing there the kōwhai flower. We did a little series called Discover New Zealand, and it was really aimed at the overseas market, but people who were, we wanted to showcase all those things that we love and see around us all the time that are very familiar to us as New Zealanders, but might not be all that well known to people overseas. So that was a key focus for the Discover New Zealand coin series. And then every year we also feature a coin with a endangered animal. And in the past, it's always been an extinct animal, but we started to focus on endangered. So this frog, Archie's frog, I'm sure many people here know that it is the world's number one most endangered amphibian. So that was a really great animal to feature and to tell that story and take it, share that story and the work that goes on in relation to preserving Archie's frog to the world. So that's a key part of what we do. So of course, when Forest and Bird approached us, actually it was a good couple of years ago, we felt that Forest and Bird and the work that Forest and Bird does and the history of Forest and Bird was such a good fit for New Zealand Post and the kind of work we do. I just brought in that quick slide which shows our Christmas stamps again. A lot of our stamps, and these ones in particular, are showcasing New Zealand's flora and fauna. So that was a lovely one to do. So of course, in working with Forest and Bird, particularly Caroline Wood, who was an amazing person to work with, we had to think very carefully, what are we going to do? How are we going to tell the history of Forest and Bird and four wee little tiny pieces of artwork? We felt that we could, how could we cover 100 years of history? Would it be better to focus on like the important people, Val Sanderson, of course, or do we feature, animals, historic photographs, what's the look and feel that we want? And in our discussions, we quite quickly came to the conclusion that we wanted it to be fresh and contemporary. We wanted it to reflect the past, represent the history, but also very much be future focused. So that's where we landed. Rachel Walker had, of course, already produced this artwork, which was focusing on Kapiti Island, Kapiti Bloom. And that we took a good look at that. We were a little bit worried at first because there's so much detail in that artwork. Would it work well as a little tiny stamp? And if we were going to use this as our basis, how are we going to get the other three stamps that we wanted to make as well? So we went to Rachel, and we were very lucky that she agreed to work with us, and she created three additional original artworks for us for the stamps. Of course, we had to consider the size of the stamps, which I've already mentioned. They're absolutely tiny, but I think Rachel did an incredible job of getting in so much detail. And as well as all the detail of the artwork and representing each of the different places that Caroline picked out and worked closely with Rachel to decide what was going to be included in each stamp, stamps have to be a practical postal thing. So they have to include a denomination. We have a little New Zealand Post fern indicator. What text do we include? And even thinking about white space, that stamps have a phosphor, element of phosphor, which is how they get sorted. And that was the job of Nick Jarve. He was the New Zealand Post designer who managed to kind of take the artworks and very sensitively add in all those other elements that we need for the stamps. So just showing here now the four different stamps. I was going to go into a little bit of detail about each one, but our wonderful experts are going into that detail. But in a nutshell, each stamp represents a specific place, the work that goes on in that place, a different element of the history behind Forest and Bird's work, beginning with the Kapiti stamp, which represents the history, and ending with a stamp that is all about the future, climate change, and the work going forward. And just to finish off, I thought I would just quickly share. So as well as the stamps, we make what we call a first day cover. And for those who aren't stamp collectors, that's basically an envelope that the stamps sit on. And then we cancel that with a specially designed stamp, which is the black one in the middle. And then last of all, we produce a miniature sheet and a miniature sheet first day cover. So they're just a couple of the different types of stamp products that collectors like to collect. And that's it from me. Thank you. And I'll stop sharing.
That was lovely. We're going to head to Tamaki Makaurau now, to Ark in the Park. Sam, over to you and the story behind the stamps that mean a lot to you.
Kia ora koutou, and thank you for all joining us tonight. And Claire, I believe, has a slideshow to show for those of you who avoid Auckland. I'm not blaming you. So Arkenham Park, where I have been working the last 2.5 years, we look after such a special range of species, including the kōkako, which I'm definitely not mad that Kapiti got on their stamp. It gave us a chance to showcase some of the other amazing species that we have up here on Tamaki Makaurau. So at Arkenham Park, again, copying Connor with a shameless plug for our website, there is a Facebook page as well. But as you can see, the Ark, we're only like a 30 to 40 minute drive from Auckland, depending on traffic and time of day. But on my first day, I went up to a viewpoint and was showing the vista, and you're standing on Puke Matakeo, who is the last hill in the Waitakere Ranges, looking out over this just sea of green, and everything I could see that was forested was the Ark in the Park project, and then some, because with the mountains you can't actually see the whole thing. It was very much a Lion King moment, just breathtaking, realizing the scope of a project that is run almost entirely by volunteers. None of these species would be around without volunteers. They started the Ark. They're the heart of it that keeps it running as well. Next slide, please. So this is where we are in relation to Auckland City. So we are somewhere between 2,200 and 2,400 hectares, depending on who's doing the GIS and whether you include the Waitakere Dam. But it's a huge area of the Ngāhere, but also so close to Auckland City and Waitakere City. So the entire ARC project was at the heart of it, is that we're an unfenced sanctuary and where it's safe to do so. I'll touch on Kōrere Dieback later, but we're open to the public, we're unfenced. We are very much a way for nature and people to be as one, given that we're so close to the heart of Tamaki Makaurau. Next slide, please. So I think, yeah, I already touched on some of this. So there is only two of us full-time in the office employed by Forest and Bird. And we have almost 4,800 bait stations and 550 traps. I'm not that fast. These are not run by staff. This is entirely run by volunteers. We've got volunteers like Bruce there out. If volunteers are trapping, each trap line gets checked every week. Without these volunteers, we wouldn't have things like kōkako, which went locally extinct and have been reintroduced. We've got the kaka, as you can see, that someone got a picture of through their binoculars using a camera, which is a skill I'm still very impressed by. We've got two endangered habitats. It's, as a plant nerd myself, it's the plants that have my heart. Four at-risk bird species. There's 172 native species in this area that we look after. It's not just the gorgeous birds you see on these stamps, but it's everything that they eat, everything that they live in, all the insects that they eat and where the insects live. It's the entire ecosystem that is also precious for us. And next slide, please. And lucky enough to have this absolutely amazing stamp, which represents all of that. We've got our birds, we've got our sea life, we've got our kauri towering over the top, and got our fungi in there as well. It's, yeah, the so hard to put all of that on a stamp, but the artist has done an amazing job. And yeah, that the vision of the arc fits perfectly with the stamp from the start. It's been from the ridges to the sea. We're not just focusing on, you know, the gorgeous birds that we have the privilege of looking after. It's that entire environment. It is from the ridges to the sea. Birds like the taiko, the black petrel, they don't see a boundary between the forest and the ocean. We can't just look after the land or just look after the ocean. It's the entire system that we're looking after. And as you can see in that photo, it's most of our volunteers, the ones that have free time to come out every Thursday, for example, are retired. But it's not just retirees that we're looking after this forest for. It's all of the youngins as well, including myself. but yeah, this photo shows it's a group from Auckland University, the Tramping Club, who come out a few times a year. They've been amazing. And student labor is phenomenal. We do give them free sausages for lunch, which helps to convince them to come out again on the Saturdays. But yeah, it's really a community project with everyone pitching in. Next slide. So yeah, the locals that we're showing on on the stamp, we've got the taiko, so that's our black petrel. So they used to be around where the ark would have been. They used to be across most of the, like, our seabirds used to have such a huge range across our country. I can't even my imagination doesn't do them justice. I spent 3 days last week in Taranaki at the Kōkako National Hui, and they were talking about how seabirds used to be nesting on Tongariro. Like on our volcanic islands in the middle of our country, we used to have seabirds nesting. So just trying to imagine what it is that we're working back towards is huge, but we're getting there. So yeah, these gorgeous taiko used to nest in areas like the Ark in the Park, but no longer do, because nesting on the ground, they don't have a lot of protection from all of our introduced predators. So at the moment, the only places that we know they nest are Aotea, Great Barrier Island, and Hoturu, Little Barrier Island. So still in the area, so there is a chance that provided we can get their home back to being nice and get rid of the overstayers that are trashing their homes, we can have these guys nesting back at the Ark. These guys nest on Hoturu and Aotea, but they travel all the way to South America, all around the Pacific. So again, it's community effort, even internationally, to keep these guys safe from things like fisheries bycatches as well. Then Kauri, anyone in the North Island, like if you've ever been to meet Tane Mehuda, there's no words that kind of sum up what a Kauri is and the mana that they have. They're just amazing, amazing raku. Then Tohora, the southern right whales, the brother to the Kauri. I probably don't have enough time to go over it, but there's an amazing Māori legend about the Tohora and the Kauri and the brothers swapping skins, which is why the Kauri have their kind of bumpy bark on them, because they swap skins with their Tohora whale brothers. And my favorite on the stamp, the Wera Wera Kōkako. So our little blue mushroom in there, the according to the internet, we're the only country that has a mushroom fungus on one of our banknotes. I'm assuming the internet is still up to date, but I'm sure someone will share information in the comments if I'm not correct. But yeah, Wera Wera Kōkako, so Wera Wera translates to hanging or to the wattles of a bird. So Wera Wera Kōkako, which we also happen to find in the southern blocks where our kōkako live, are named after the blue wattles of the kōkako. They've got Nene, the Dracophyllum, which translates to dragon-leaved. So cool. There are just Dr. Seuss trees in there. It's an amazing habitat. And then we also have the long-tailed bat, Pekapekatoroa, Pepeketoa, Hotchstetter's frog. It's, the Waitakere Ranges are just a breathtaking place. And they speak quickly, but probably not quickly enough. There's just so many amazing species. Next slide, please. And it's not just invasive fists that we're trying to take care of from the ridges to the sea. Started looking a little bit more like the sea and the ridges with the recent flooding. So this is the floods from the cyclones earlier this year. And you can see it's just cleared things out. But compared to everywhere else in our community where people lost their homes, the Nahere held up better because, I mean, trees are made to slow down floods and made to soak up water. So after seeing what I saw around my home and around my neighbors, I was expecting it to be far worse when I got to the forest. But for those sites like this, it's actually fared a lot better than the rest of the environment. So it's, yeah, the having an intact forest really made a huge difference. And next slide. But the floods do tend to take our bait stations and traps for a bit of a ride. You can see where the water usually would be, where that trap got washed to, halfway up a tree, which makes the trap checking a little bit more of a challenge after floods. and final slide, I think, one of the last. So we also have bats. So once Te Piringa, the Auckland City Walk, opens up, you might get a chance to be pooped on by a bat, depending on what time of day you're up. They are pooping literally onto the boardwalk, which is super exciting. And this is how we have bats. Volunteers checked traps 16,000 times last year. Removed 823 pests. That's just from trapping, not including baiting, not including our neighbors who have traps on their private land. We've visited bait stations 8,000 times just from the hours that volunteers remembered to write in our book, 8,300 hours. This year, we're looking to get back up to 2,000, provided there's no more cyclones or lockdowns. And even our neighbors are on board. We wouldn't have known that our kōkako Grant across the road from us, she keeps nesting across the road, not in the ark where we made her a nice home, because she's got wings and doesn't care about roads. She's nested across the road and has two young kōkako chicks. So that's one of her babies from this year in the photo at the bottom. And I think that's, I might have one more slide. I think that's us. That's us, yes. Thank you.
Oh, so much to celebrate, Sam, and congratulations to the work everyone's doing. I love this kind of joint story of the contribution of volunteers. It's worth a seminar in its own right, eh? We couldn't possibly do it without them and the sacrifices they make. Scott, I'll bring you into the talk now, and I'm really looking forward to hearing about the fourth stamp in the Centennial Collection and the story behind it.
Thanks, Lynn. Well, Pomaria Koto, Pokatu Nelson, Oeno Hoana, or Scott Burnett, Tokawingawa. Good evening. My name's Scott. I live in Nelson and I'm the Top of the South Regional Conservation Manager for Forest and Bird. It's awesome. We've saved the best stamp till last. It's also worth the most. I looked it up and you can send an oversized letter with it. This stamp represents the changing climate, nature's fragility, conservation activism, and the future. The stamp depicts the extraordinary flora, fauna, and natural beauty of the Denison and Stockton plateaus, collectively known as the Buller Plateau. These plateaus sit 600 metres above the coastal plain east and north of Westport on the west coast of the South Island. In the background of the stamp, you can see the Buller Plateau landscape. It's a dramatic combination of coal-bearing rock, wetlands, windswept subalpine forest, and tussock. The Buller Plateau has been at the centre of huge conservation efforts over the last 20 years, trying to stop coal mining from destroying the area's unusual geological formations and the specially adapted micro-ecosystems of this challenging place. There are no amazing forest giants here, like up in Ark in the Park. Instead, the environment encourages plants to do the opposite, to hunker down and hug the ground out of the wind and the elements. One of these special plants is represented on the stamp. On the lower left of the stamp, with the red fruit, is the mountain rimu, or pygmy pine. It's New Zealand's smallest conifer. It's a member of the podocarp family, and yet it only grows to 30 centimetres in height. Beside the mountain rimu is one of our carnivorous land snails, the Poelophanta. This one is Poelophanta patrickensis, a species that only lives on the Buller Plateau. It is nationally endangered because of habitat loss from mining operations and predation from introduced pest species. Then to the right of the snail, eyebright flowers, the yellow flowers there. Eyebright, or Euphrasia, is a genus of around 450 species of flowering plant, often found in alpine meadows all around the world. And here in New Zealand, there are around a dozen species. And the name eyebright comes from its use in traditional medicine for treating eye conditions. The centerpiece of the stamp is the rare forest ringlet, or pepipudi butterfly. It used to be found in suitable habitat across the North Island and in the top of the South, but has been in rapid decline in recent decades and is now rare. This decline has been attributed to loss of habitat and predation from wasps, rats, or mice. However, there has not been yet sufficient scientific study to absolutely confirm the cause or causes of the decline. This is emblematic of how little we understand about our insect life. Of our native butterflies, the forest ringlet is thought to be the most at risk of becoming extinct. Finally, the aptly named avatar moth is pictured in the top left of the stamp. It has an interesting story. In 2012, Forest and Bird organised a bioblitz on the Denison Plateau to document its unique flora and fauna. The bioblitz was part of a campaign to try to have the land legally protected as a nature reserve. During the bioblitz, scientists supported by Forest and Bird staff and volunteers discovered a nationally important population of forest ringlet butterflies and a new species of moth. This was later named the Avatar moth by the New Zealand public. It was named after the movie Avatar, about a peaceful species on an alien planet whose survival and way of life were threatened by a mining company. The Avatar moth has only been found on the Buller Plateau. Claire, I think you can take down the stamp now and return to the speaker view. Forest and Bird has campaigned for decades to protect New Zealand's unique landscapes from being destroyed by mining for coal, gold, and other precious minerals. And last week, we're excited to say, Forest and Bird won a pivotal environment court case against the proposed Te Kuha coal mine. This is the first time that the environment has trumped economics in the decision about whether the mine should go ahead. In the last 20 years, Te Kuha is the third big coal mine on the Buller Plateau that Forest and Bird has tried to stop going ahead, but it's the first time we've won. The Happy Valley Mine in 2004 and 2005, the Escarpment Mine 2011 and 12 were granted permits despite sustained campaigning and legal action from Forest and Bird and other groups. So this recent victory, it's really special. Te Kuha is located on the Buller Plateau behind Westport on Buller District Council Water Reserve land. In 2017, the proposed mine was given permission by council. Forest and Bird appealed the resource consents to the Environment Court. At the same time, the mining company pursued a legal case to determine that the Crown Minerals Act has precedence or primacy over the Reserves Act. Forest and Bird challenged this all the way to the Supreme Court and won the case in 2020. Then last year, the Environment Court hearing was held and the decision in Forest and Bird's favour was released last week. The win and the difference in this case is due to better environmental protections and legislation today, including the National Policy Statement for Freshwater Management and stronger rules in the West Coast Regional Council plans. As someone relatively new to Forest and Bird, I'd like to thank everyone involved in the Buller Coal campaign over the last 20 years. Whether you were actively involved on the ground, wrote a letter or a submission, or donated funds for the legal action, thank you for your efforts. They have made a difference. The final thing that the stamp represents is our changing climate and the additional pressures this creates for our flora and fauna. We regularly talk about the twin crises of climate change and biodiversity loss. These crises are linked because climate change and species loss are both caused by human actions, and it is in our power to address both. Climate change also adds significant pressures to species already under threat due to habitat loss. For example, here in New Zealand, climate warming is expanding the range of pest plants and animals that will decimate special ecosystems like those on the Buller Plateau, unless we are proactive in looking after them. Forest and Bird started raising awareness about climate change from the early 1990s, and today climate advocacy is at the heart of all of our campaigns. During this centennial year and election year, Forest and Bird will be campaigning to make climate change a key election issue, championing nature-based solutions such as browsing mammal control and making room for rivers to help our world adapt to climate change while boosting biodiversity and ensuring a resilient future for nature and for people. Ngā mihi, thank you. And now I'll hand back to Lynn to see if we have any questions.
Oh, kia ora, Scott. Actually, I've got one. I was thinking about the stamp when we were working on the media releases about Te Kuha last week and thinking that it's such an emblem of hope. You know, we didn't know that when the stamp was designed. It was a beautiful thing and it told a story. But I feel, don't you, that this has added something to make it almost the story, you know? That never to give up hope, even if it takes years and court action and hundreds of thousands of dollars and legal decisions, you know, we must never give up.
That's right. Yeah, I totally agree, Lynn. And I've been buying tea towel versions of the stamp from the New Zealand Post website to give to family and friends after this court win.
What does it mean to you to when you first saw the stamp and you were thinking about the stories behind it, and this being a story that you know very well, what does it mean to you kind of personally, Scott?
I think it's really powerful. You know, imagery can really convey a lot of meaning. And I think these stamps really capture the Forest and Bird story. So for me personally, they're really empowering. And I'm just delighted that they've been released.
Same question for you. Yeah, same question for you, really. I mean, Ark in the Park, as though you've been there for a few years, I know how much it means to you. So to have its story, and a wider story actually, told in this tiny little stamp, you know, when you saw it, what did it mean to you? How did you feel about it?
It was amazing. And yeah, the chance to see such a representative of the whole ecosystem on there. It's not just, you know, the birds that get all the airtime. It's the entire ecosystem, everything that's needed for the environment to be healthy. I'm a bit jealous of the stamp that Scott got to talk about with all the imprints on it. But yeah, the there's just so much across the whole country to fit so much of into four stamps. It's it's just so exciting getting to share all these special species with everyone else as well.
The next question's come in for you. How can we give ideas for more flora and fauna subjects on New Zealand Post stamps?
Well, I mean, everyone has a different favourite species. So if we just ask everyone, I'm pretty sure you'll have an endless supply of stamps. I mean, some of my favourite are the velvet worms. They're super cool. Not only the stamps this time, but maybe next time.
Critter of the week stamps. But if people have ideas, Lynette, how can they, you know, we want to see more flora and fauna on the stamps, because that is a really powerful message. Yeah. You know, how can they people go about it?
Well, they can just email me. Yeah, my actual job, my main role at New Zealand Post is the program manager for the stamps and collectibles team. And and I get a lot of ideas coming through to me, as well as we do our own research on obviously we quite often look for centenaries or a significant moment in time, but we regularly do stamps and coins and other collectibles based around environmental themes, because we know that people really care about it. It's so important to New Zealanders. It's such, you know, a core part of who we are as New Zealanders too. So if people want to share, put forward ideas, I'm always really, really keen and open to hear those ideas. Thinking about what we've got coming up next year, we're looking at doing something around marine reserves. We're hoping to do backyard pollinators has been on the list for a while, so I'm really hoping to get that one out next year. We've thought about Critter of the Week. I would love to do that. I think that would make a fantastic stamp. We've done a lot in the past as well. So it's always, we've focused on butterflies and moths and lots of botanical stamps. So yeah, it's just really a matter of emailing me. I'm happy to provide my email address in the chat too.
Our time is almost over. I just have a little quick question, Nikki, for you, because as you say, predator control, pest control is such a big part of our campaigning, understandably, this year. When you talk about new tools in the toolkit, how are you feeling about alternatives to what we have at the moment that are kind of, you know, holding the fort but not making enough progress?
Yeah, I think there's a lot of work going on in the research side of Predator Free 2050 into new tools, because, as you say, the tools we've got, they're good at holding the line, but they might not get us across the line. I'm feeling positive that the research is being done, and got to remain positive, as you said before. You know, keep up the hope.
Exactly. I think Connor, your Pekka Pekka story is rather like that too, because you've had the success in your part of the country, but I'm hearing good stories around other parts of the country. So our previous Bird of the Year winner, controversial, the signs are looking good, eh?
Yeah, I mean, it's awesome to see little success stories coming, cropping up everywhere. It's inspiring as a and energizing as a conservationist to see those sorts of wins, but also we need wins everywhere, because conservation isn't in one area, it's the whole country, it's everywhere you look. So certainly.
Well, that is our time is up. So my thanks to all of our guests, to Lynette Townsend and Nikki Snowyink, Connor Wallace, Scott Burnett and Sam Lincoln. And behind the scenes, this webinar was made possible by Claire Shepherd and Sarah Satterthwaite, working very hard. Thanks to you also, and to Caroline Wood. Also want to acknowledge her for her beautiful work on this. This has been the second of a monthly speaker series to mark Forest and Birds Centennial. The series will cover a wide range of conservation topics. I know the next one, can't tell you, top secret, but very exciting and based in the South Island, I can tell you that. So keep an eye on the Forest and Bird website for details and more information about today's speakers. And to sign off, I'm passing that over, Scott, to you.
Kia koutou. Okay, we'll finish with a karakia. Tēnei te mihi ki rangi, tēnei te mihi ki papa. Tēnei te mihi ki a rawa tamariki, tēnei te mihi ki a tāne. Mō te wehenga, mō te haora, mō ngā mātaronga, tihei, Māori ora.
Kia ora. Thank you, everybody. Go well, everyone.